Hello, I'm Davey Alleman. I'm a practicing dentist for over 10 years with a focus and an emphasis on biomimetic dentistry. This is the idea that the intact tooth is our guide to reconstruction. And through adhesive dentistry, stress-reducing techniques, we can mimic the natural tooth in both form and function through these techniques that will benefit your patient greatly. Now, one confusing thing for many dentists is this idea of C-factor. Now, any time that we do a biomimetic restoration or even any kind of resin restoration, we have to understand that there is polymerization stress that has the possibility to significantly weaken your bond strength and your seal to the tooth. C-factor is defined as the ratio of bonded to unbonded surfaces. So in theory, this can be calculated on any preparation to understand how big the surface area is within the preparation and calculate how much polymerization stress will result if we do a simplified filling technique. Now here we've got a very common situation that dentists face on a daily basis. Whether you practice in the United States, Europe, Africa, South America, Asia, it doesn't really matter. Oftentimes you are dealing with a very common pathology, which is caries, or you are replacing an older restoration that is starting to have additional breakdown from the forces of occlusion and also perhaps a lack of hygiene from the patient. Now, when we have a class one cavity, a class two, a class three, or class four, we can calculate the C factor stress based off of the number of walls and the surface area. When we have a flat surface or something like a class four, this would be considered low C factor. Now, the C factor in this situation will direct how the composite moves and flows. A concept that was introduced in the 1980s showed that when molecules can slip past each other while polymerization stress is occurring and we have a high degree of flow, this can compensate for the stress that is being accumulated in the restoration. So when we have a single wall or low C factor, the directional of the composite movement or the composite shrinkage is going towards the desired interface, which is the tooth structure or the dentin interface. Chances are very rarely do you see a single surface restoration. You are seeing preparations that are located in the proximal area, such as a class two, or you've got a large carious lesion on a occlusal surface that is hard for the patient to keep clean and thus resulted in the occlusal surface being destroyed. And so when we look at a class two or a class one composite, we have to understand that this is not a flat surface and the C factor stresses are significantly different. So when we look at a preparation, it's easier to say, does the preparation look like a plate, a bowl, or a cup, rather than trying to calculate the mathematical ratio of bonded to unbonded surfaces. Now here on a class one, which most dentists, when they first get out of dental school, feel like this is the easiest restoration. They don't have to rebuild a contact. They don't have to struggle with matrixing. And they think a class one is going to be the easiest thing that they do in that given day. But unfortunately, with the class one restoration, we have multiple walls. And these multiple walls, if we've got large degrees of differences in our substrate or our hierarchy of bondabilities, that composite movement can move away from the bonded interface, create a gap, an early biologic failure, and sensitivity and discomfort to the patient. So when I look at a class one, I actually view this as the most challenging in terms of a bonding procedure, because the composite has to decide which way it's going to move. And in this small 10-minute video, we are going to discuss how we can trick the composite so it always thinks it's in low C factor, or it's always moving and flowing towards the deepest part of the restoration. With the class one, like we see on the upper second molar, if we don't have a strategic way to mitigate polymerization stress, we can lose 50 to 70% of our bond strength. Now, a preparation that is a veneer or a class four, we would say that this looks like a plate. And so the composite has really only one direction that it can move towards, and that is towards the dentin bond. Now, one thing that my dad has been teaching dentists for the past two decades is an idea of a hierarchy of bondability. Now, a hierarchy of bondability is the idea and the notion that different parts of the tooth bond at different strengths and at different times based off of how much mineralization is located in each of these different areas. If we fail to neutralize or reverse the effects of a hierarchy of bondability, then the polymerization stress will move towards the faster maturing bond and away from the slower developing bond. Now, a slow developing bond doesn't necessarily mean that it's a weaker bond, just simply means it will take more time to develop and establish its full strength. So when we neutralize the hierarchy of bondability in a medium, a high, or even a low C factor, it's how we allow the bond to mature in a stress-free environment for a period of time. In an indirect restoration, we call this immediate dentin sealing. On a direct restoration, we still call it immediate dentin sealing, but we have to decouple, or we have to separate the slow maturing bonds from the fast maturing bonds for a period of time. Because if our increments get too thick, as the material shrinks and hardens, it will move away from our desired interface, which is the deepest portion of the preparation. On this particular case, where we're restoring the second molar and the first molar, we can see three distinct preparations, and we could calculate the C factor on each of these. All of these preparations have medium to high C factor, and we also have decay that if we don't adequately address by utilizing a technique and a material that creates reproducible results, such as caries detecting dye, we may lose our bond strength, even if we understand the principles of C factor. So we always focus on our caries removal endpoints. And our caries removal endpoints, depending on how deep we are in the tooth, determines if we have complete caries removal or partial caries removal. Now on the second molar, this began as a class one, and as the caries extended towards the lingual, this became more of a class two preparation from an occlusal lingual standpoint. But we can see that all the red and all the pink have been eliminated. And so we have a high bondability to our dentin that can exceed the bond potential of enamel. This is because when we have dentin, which is a tough material, it's got 50% inorganic, 30% collagen, and 20% water. There's an inherent toughness, but it does take longer for that bond to develop. Now, on the first molar, we also have an occlusal lingual, but the narrowness of this preparation, we would consider this to have a higher C factor. Now, a more conservative preparation will oftentimes have more tooth to support the restoration, but the C factor and the competing walls can negatively influence that bond potential, because the composite has to decide if it's moving towards the mesial, the distal, or the occlusal. Now on the proximal lesion on the first molar, you can see that we went from something that looked very cuppy bullish. And as we flared this out and beveled our proximal enamel, we've in turn also lowered the C factor to a certain degree. The surface area of the bonded to the unbonded surface area would actually be calculated as less. So once we've got our caries removal endpoints, then we can continue our process after we've analyzed the C factor and say, how can I trick the composite so it only moves in a single direction? Now, as we establish our bonds, and in this case, we're bonding to superficial dentin that's caries free, intermediate dentin that's caries free, and a small area of deep dentin that is caries free, or a small area that has a little bit of inner caries, we can adequately predict our bond potential within these preparations. In most of the areas of dentin, I'm expecting a bond strength anywhere between 40 and 50 megapascals. That small area of pink, perhaps I'm getting only 30, but that's still the same cohesive strength and bond potential of our enamel. The only difference is it takes 5 to 30 minutes for you to establish a 30 to 50 megapascal bond strength to your dentin. Now, if we ignore the effects of C-factor and use a 2 millimeter or a bulk fill strategy, the polymerization stress will quickly negate your bond potential, going from 50 down to 25 or 20 megapascals, or in some instances, you could lose upwards to 80%. Instead of 50, you're down to 10. And so we do not recommend utilizing a bulk fill material or a 2 millimeter increment of composite in those first few layers. Our second layer, after we place our adhesive, we always recommend that you use a 2 or a 3 bottle adhesive system to separate hydrophilic and hydrophobic chemistries. Our second layer will be a thin resin coat. Now, the resin coating acts as a thickening of our adhesive, but also as it's touching these surfaces, even though it's touching walls on the lingual and on the buccal and on the distal or the occlusal, the volume is so thin that the vectors of shrinkage go towards the tooth. This actually improves our bond strength rather than decreases because the volume is so thin. And the time it takes to apply a resin coat or a thin layer of flowable on top of your adhesive further decouples those slow maturing bonds from the faster maturing ones. Now, as we continue the process, if we filled this too quickly, we could still lose bond strength. Because remember, it takes about 5 to 10 minutes for the bond to dentin to be equal to the fast maturing bond of enamel, which is around 30 megapascals. So here, as I'm building this up, I'm using small wedge-shaped increments to really help mitigate some of that polymerization stress. This was pioneered by a doctor out of Sardinia, Italy, Dr. Simone Della Peri, where he's been able to use this stress-reducing direct technique for teeth that are severely compromised and even in situations of large cusp replacing restorations. Now, another way to help mitigate polymerization stress would be the use of a polyethylene fiber such as Ribbond, or you could perhaps do an indirect restoration that allows you to fully decouple and still mitigate the effects of C-factor. And so how you fill these restorations that either look like a plate, a bowl, or a cup based off of their C-factor can really determine if that composite restoration lasts 1 year, 3 years, 5 years, or perhaps 15 years. Biomimetic dentistry should be a bottom-to-top approach rather than a top-down approach. And so the anatomy, while it makes all the dentists feel really good, if you lose the bond strength deep, you're going to have significant problems with your patient's dental experience. You know, we all want our restorations to last a long time, but we also want our patients to be very comfortable after we've spent this time to properly treat the decay and also the time it takes to build and create a restoration that mimics that of the natural dentition. And so while these restorations take more time, they have the ability or the potential to significantly outlive many of the previous techniques that were mechanically retained, such as an amalgam restoration or a restoration that is rushed with a composite material where they're trying to do a bulk fill strategy simply because a manufacturer said, this material is bulk fill compatible. When I look at these teeth, I'm extremely proud of the way they look, but I'm more focused on how am I tricking the composite so when I place that ball of composite and I condense it, which direction is it moving? Have I adequately neutralized the hierarchy of bondability? And is this tooth now connected side to side, front to back, and also top to bottom? So I'm regaining the biomechanics that were originally lost from either an old restoration or a large carious or crack situation. If you'd like to learn more about C-factor, check the links in the description. If you want to learn more about our training programs, we offer in-person and also online programs that can really help you become a master of C-factor stress. Because C-factor stress is not something that you can get away from. It's almost like gravity. But we understand that an airplane can overcome the effects of gravity just as well as you will be able to overcome the effects of C-factor by understanding polymerization stress, flow of composites, how to properly layer your composites, and strategies such as indirect, semi-direct, and stress-reduced direct techniques to help maintain your high bond strengths that you desire. Get bonded, stay bonded.